Welcome, everybody, and we're very, very pleased tonight to be able to host Vicente Guallart for his first lecture here at the AA that is part of an AA program. He's been here before, but as part of a program of lectures hosted by the journal A&D. But now it's finally an opportunity for him to for us to have him here on our behalf, which is really very nice. It's a delight to have you here. Just to many of you I know will already know Vicente's work, but I want to just talk a little bit about the trajectory of his work and what I think makes it very exciting for us to have him visit here. Vicente started his own practice in 92 after leaving José Luis Mateo's practice in MAP Arquitectos. Since 2001, he's been a director of the master's course in advanced architecture at the Polytechnic University in Barcelona. Now, in those nine years between those two dates, he's done a lot of very interesting work in a variety of different media, and is continuing to extend that portfolio in quite fascinating ways. What I think is most interesting about it is the way in which it cuts across very many media and many different scales of work. In 2002, he won the prize for the Ciutat de Barcelona prize for work on the Media House project that was a joint venture with MIT's Media Lab. He has now, since 2003, been a director of a project in urbanism and planning called Sociopolis. Many of you already have the books on your shelves, I know. And that is a project that combines the work of many different architects whom are being directed by Vicente. Now, I think if you start looking through his work, you'll notice that there are innovations that are happening at each scale. If you look at his houses for single family projects, the interesting thing about them is that the way they hold on to a sense of territory that is not, in a way, some naive repetition of what we would understand by nature or a kind of regional landscape, but take it in new directions and have what you might call an attentiveness to a territorial condition, I think we maybe say it that way. If you look at his multifamily housing, it's interesting in the way in which he's trying to take on board new understandings of changing social and demographic patterns and propose new housing solutions that are attentive to these. If you look at the way he's working in urbanism, it's very much an interface with landscape, very much an interface with nature. And in such a way that it proposes bringing landscape back in, sort of restoring a kind of landscape in the heart of an expanding regional metropolis. So there are a number of very interesting approaches to things at many different scales that I think makes his work very exciting and something that we can learn from a great deal. Now, the work that he is, some of the work that he's most well known for has to do with new media and digital work. And so back in 94, when he started working with Nuria Diaz on developing architecture CDs, I just discovered tonight that that wasn't purely out of principle. It was partly principle combined with the fact that there just wasn't buildings to build. But in a sense, now we bear the fruit of that kind of crossover and can see the way in which explorations in media turn into interesting directions for architecture. And I think that's something that's very important to cultivate, and perhaps in a dialogue between the Polytechnic University and the AA. So tonight we're very pleased and very honored to have Vicente Guallart here, and I'd like to turn it now over to Vicente. Thank you very much.
Thank you. In fact, today is my first full lecture here at the AA. We just finished some. I realized 2 months ago that we already finished 4 buildings. But when I was planning to do this lecture, I thought that I would prefer not to. I am more excited. I don't know why, but I am more excited to talk about ideas than not to talk about facts, let's say. So in my website, you can find some images of the buildings that we already built. But I would like to talk about this concept. In fact, this is the title of a book that I am trying to finish, like from 2 years ago. About some idea that somehow is the way we work. No, we are always working in a very strange situation because we are always jumping off scales. My background is we work as a media producer making CD-ROMs on architectures. I think one of the first that were done. And we are obviously making buildings, but also I think that in my office and myself, we have a political background and a political interest about how cities or how the territory should be done or how the society should be organized. That this is something that architects is not talking anymore. Architects today are much more concentrated on forms or in geometry than not about how to create habitat or how to create environments for the people, no? So in this different approach, we have at least like 3 different entries to our architecture. That is the media, that could say the digital world, the mountains, that could say the natural world, and the architecture, that it is something artificial. We discover this concept of these three layers in this project in the year 93, in a competition called About a House with No Style, in which we propose a house in the middle of the desert. We thought that we should do something that in which the architecture disappear when the landscape is so strong. Landscape is much more, or mountains many times are much more interesting or beautiful than architecture itself, and we thought we should do something in which our house should be for someone who is working in the digital world, but its physical representation is something related with landscape, not related with a building or a box. No, the box or the space for the living space should be underground. This is kind of corridor with some volumes. This is the result on the landscape, and in fact, this is the wall projection, architecture in some moment, or the people today is projected to the wall, not only through architecture or through the physical thing, but also through digital things, through images. That somehow was this. Here we have the media. The form that we have in front of us should be more related with landscape, mountains, and architecture, or the places that we live maybe are something that tends to disappear in a bigger environment. No, I would like, in fact, I was thinking that I would like to talk about urbanism or about the cities or about how the people live. No, in the last years there has been a big discussion about this kind of generic urbanism where the world is everything the same. So the city, some people say the city is not important anymore because what is important are the buildings. Sometimes we discuss that if we think about the Aldo Rossi text about the architecture of the city, that was some way to make cities by making buildings, that you can see many of incredible buildings here in London or in Barcelona. In Barcelona, in the 80s, there was some discussion about what it was called the urban project, that is something about renewal or vague areas or areas that are abandoned. But we have another scale, that is this territorial vision, no? So we can think about the what we are going to do, just thinking on buildings, thinking on cities, or thinking in the territory itself. So I like, and I would like to make this explanation because for me it was very important from the strategical point of view. If we think about some geographical situation in which we could think that we have a sea with a river, for example, in some moment of the history, there was a foundation of this city, no? Some Roman people, many times, they make a cross, and then they found a city, no? And the city, many of the European cities were based in this Roman structures that in some moment of the history they make a wall. So this is what many cities is known as the historical center. In some moment of the history in the 19th century there were some extensions with grid, no, like the Cerdà grid in Barcelona, no? We could think about these grid extensions. Obviously there were the train was arriving to all these centers. And in some moment of the history, in the 20th century, they start to make also highways, and the most clear representation of the highways of many cities in Europe are the ring, no, like the periphery in Paris or the rondas in Barcelona, no. There was some. The periphery, when the cars start to exist, the American way of life, the people start to live somehow outside the cities in some suburban situation, no? And if we think that there were some other places here, if I remember reading a Neuromancer book saying some kind of big metropolis between New York and Atlanta, what he called the El Ensanche, no, the extension. No? But today we live in a situation, so the future, some future could be a kind of huge metropolis that you in London and in England, maybe you could think about the territory like completely built. But today we are in a kind of, again, a foundational situation in which because we have a kind of global, we are living in a global city, it's not clear, the centers are not anymore the centers itself. We are living not in a metropolis, but in a metapolis. The title of this year Biennale of Venice is Meta City. Metapolis is a discontinuous metropolis. That means that we must to deal about not only the architecture project is not only related with what is artificial, what the man is doing, but also with the nature. We should know what to do with the nature, and we should have a plan about which project we have for the whole territory, both what is the city, but also what is the mountains, what is the territory, no? In some moment of some years ago, we thought that instead thinking that everything should grow and grow and grow, we could think about the landscape growing to the cities. No, in some moment, the landscape could think that okay, now is moment. Some people could decide that instead to grow the cities to the landscape could grow to the city. And that's what is interesting. So we are today in an interesting situation in which we don't know if the cities is growing to outside or to inside, up, down. It's not clear which is the direction, no? In this situation, there are people that say, okay, we are in a kind of generic city, let's make good buildings, let's forget about the city because it's impossible to control, etc. No? From my point of view, I have an optimistic background. I have an optimistic approach about the future. And that's why we think that we should not only to deal with the reality and to put McDonald's or sometimes to put some interesting restaurants, but we should make proposals to direct or to orientate the reality in any scale. This drawing, as you see, in a territorial scale. So, but today I'm starting in this territorial diagram, but we'll finish in a house, of the interior of a house. No, so when we work as an architect, we must think from my point of view, we should think at the same time in many scales at the same time, because our goal is to build habitats or to generate the habitat for the people that today is not an statical habitat. The people live in a discontinuous situation. They live here, sometimes they spend the weekend here, they work sometimes here, they are connected to internet in some other place, you are taking a plane, going like another capital. So we are living in a, let's say, wide situation, but we should know where to focus our work. In fact, in a trip that I make some years ago, I realized that the landscape many times is much more interesting than architecture or the cities themselves. Not today, because there is not interest about the cities. The cities is what we are building is just pure economy, you know. So I make this statement, no? If architecture is landscape, then buildings are mountains. If we are thinking that a landscape is part of our project, then we should think about buildings in a different way. Buildings are not anymore this machine d'habité de Le Corbusier, this artificial environment where they were spending energy, but we should make buildings in a more intelligent and maybe ecological way, learning from nature. I'm interested not only about landscape, but also about nature and about the nature of nature. That means the rules that are behind things that make things work. I was also interested in this Chinese approach to the landscape, and we made some collage to try to explain these ideas, no? And in some moment in this geographical approach where Barcelona is already done, is finished, there is no more space to grow, I propose that maybe Barcelona should grow to the sea and should create some artificial islands and extension of the airport. So in order if this was the place where the Romans make the foundation, maybe again we should think that instead to make theme parks like are some in Spain, we should think about growing to inside. No? So that means to concentrate energy to the cities in order somehow to protect the environment. No? From my point of view, we should grow to inside and we should compact cities, but at the same time, nature should go to the cities instead, cities go to outside. And one day, one mayor called me and told me and asked me, Vicente, I heard that you are expert making mountains. Could you build me a mountain? And he showed me this picture. This is Denia. It's a touristic city in the Mediterranean, and this is where the city was found. Again, I mean, we are dealing with geography. With geography is the word, the interesting word in which we are working. No? The idea, this is where the Romans found the city, where the Christians were, the Arabs were there, they destroyed the city. I mean, it is this kind of full of history. And in some moment of this mountain, they destroyed the city and they put agriculture over there because the city moved there. No? So before, the city was here, but some Christians destroy the city, and then the city moved there, and they sold that in order to make agriculture. And also they sold this area in order to take a stone to make the harbor. And that's how is today this mountain, no? With this Arab castle, this place that is full of history. And the mayor, from my point of view, had a great vision because he said, okay, instead to make a shopping mall here near the highway, instead to make a shopping mall in the periphery, why not to do something interesting here? Why don't we make a parking in order to make the historical center just for pedestrian people, an auditorium, and make it some commercial area or whatever, in order to bring the energy to the center, no? So. But the center was a mountain, and then the question here was, this was the diagram, no? So let's rebuild the surface of the mountain and let's put inside some functions, no? Obviously, the question was how to build a mountain, because we could think that the mountain is just an epidermic question, so we could make a kind of surface and then inside to put like a regular structure, or we could just making a landscape restoration. That was another option. But here the question was to follow the statement that we made before. If architecture is landscape, then buildings are mountains, no? We discovered, we did many things at the same time, but we discovered this painting from Violet Leduc. You know, Violet Leduc was one was the person who started to study the Gothic architecture in the 19th century in France. He made restoration of many French cathedrals. And this person that was one of the fathers of Gaudí, for example, he was interested about mountains. He has some writings that say, God could not invent mountains without having the geometry. So he was looking for some geometries behind this kind of organic thing, no? He found some rules, some rhombedic rules, in which he was using in order to paint all these surfaces, no? And in our case, the mountains were much more stupid, no? This is like the typical Mediterranean mountain that you see is cut to make a highway. They put here like houses, they put some trees. So it's, this mountain is very stupid mountain, no? So this is like the stupid surface of this mountain with no epic at all, no? It's the normal surface. But if you study this, you can discover obviously some patterns about where the plants are, how this is there is no ground, this is just the stones. And obviously, Violet didn't know Mandelbrot. Mandelbrot was talking about fractal geometries. He was talking about the image, the previous image that I showed you about the mountains was done because the people who make software start to use fractal geometry to make these mountains. And then we thought that what we should do is to look for the origin of this mountain. And if Mandelbrot was right, what we should do is just to take one of the stones and then to analyze it in order, because if we found the rules of this stone, then we'll find the rules of the mountain. And then we were surprised because all the faces were like triangular. We were studying the geometry, and what we did was to take the same stone, and we did a lot of pictures, and we discovered that always you see here is a triangle, no? So this is a stone that I found in that place. You see, they are always triangle. This stone, in fact, is a pyramid. It's a small pyramid. And I didn't know why there was this form of this stone. But I thought that if Mandelbrot was right, again, we should do another zoom. And what we did was to make a microscopic section of this stone. And we found another, in some areas, another, some, let's say, similar geometry with these triangles. And in some other areas, we found these rhomboedric crystals. No? This is the limestone that when it's crystallized, it generates this rhomboedric structure. And then we understood what we should do is to try to enlarge this structure, like somehow like the stem cells, when they are trying to make bodies based in something that is very basic. Based in this basic geometry, what we produced was this is the hole in plan, and these rhomboedric structures that are the same. A rhomboedric, you know, that is a cube that you move to points, and is okay. So what we did was, okay, let's make, I don't know, my English is not very good, I'm sorry. So here, if you have a structure that is a rhomboedrus, the projection in plan of a rhomboedrus is an hexagon that is here. Okay, let's see, the hexagon is here. And this hexagon, what our idea was to make a rhomboedric structure and to have three different sizes of hexagons in order to be able to generate a surface, but a surface based in some structure that come from inside to outside. No? So this was the diagram. Let's make a building in which the foundation is in the floor, but also in the wall. And then we have this hexagon structure that we, if you see from this side, you found this. And then the idea was to make this surface. No? So we were studying which kind, this is the hexagon, and this was the structure. We were thinking to make some holes or to cut them to make a path, because what was interesting is that the people could walk through the mountain in order to enter through here. I mean, they could enter through here, obviously, but they could also walk through the mountain in order to enter to different places of the building. So if you think that this is a mountain, the people should be able to move. The slope was 30 degrees, that is more or less like a staircase, so the people should be able to move. So we were studying which kind of geometry we should do, and then a lot of work, we decided that based in this hexagon, if you put the hexagon in plan, you can make like a macro topography. You rotate, and now is the 30 degrees. And then in this surface, you have areas with 10 degrees, 20 degrees, and 30 degrees. But we were working with this surface, and our idea was that these hexagons, instead to make something like a French 18th century geometry, everything the same, we should find some geometry that could be very simple to build, but at the same time could have some complexity inside. So with this piece that we develop, if you put many of these elements together, the interesting of this element is that you can rotate, and this piece can connect to the other in the six directions. So at that moment, the people could be able, this is with the three different scales, at that moment the people could be able to move through here with different slopes. Okay. But it looks like complex, but what we know what is behind. Behind, in fact, the pillars are these rhomboedric structures that are supporting some hexagons that have some small macro topography inside. No? So this is the plan of this is the plan of this element. And the idea obviously was that we should use the same stone and the same material that we find. We find this is the section, no? Today there is a tunnel. So the idea should be to remake this and to put some activity here. No? So this is the image from above, in which obviously we should be use the stone of the quarry to finish the building. So the last act of this quarry will be to rebuild itself. No? This is an absolutely, I mean, this obviously is a mountain, but it's a very urban project in which we discover some Roman rest here. We put some order around. Somehow we are following the history. Here we have some Arab castle, but what we are doing is somehow following the history. You know? So this is part of the surface with some people sitting here, playing music and looking to the landscape. And inside, what we did was to study some other crystallographic, the way as the limestone is is crystallized. And what we decided was to put the three different uses, something more related with commercial activities, some auditorium, and some hotel and spa, with different geometries, and to make holes inside this structure in order to make it. No? So here, this was this structure, and what we did was to make a big hole in order to arrange some commercial activities, and also to keep some vision of the existing quarry in order to generate something that is a public space in the inside, and with some void in the upper part. If you see the upper image, this void is here. Right? This is this void. So this tower that you see is very funny, because you see the tower and it looks like it's connected with the stone. No? The auditorium, in fact, was, I will not explain this building because I would like to explain, to show some other projects, but the auditorium is, this is the lobby with this rhombedic structure, and inside the interior of the auditorium was a kind of music box, making a landscape and also making the chairs organized as part of the mountain itself. And the other and the most dramatical space was the hotel with the spa, in which we keep also this 16 query. You see here that what we do is to make this this structure that is connected with the Arab geometry, this very complex geometry of the Arabs. And then what we proposed was to do this. This is a competition that we won, and we are still discussing because there were some political change, but we are working still on this project, no? Okay, so this idea that was a kind of very primitive, I mean, the way as we somehow propose, let's make mountains, and then someone say, why don't we make a mountain? When you have an idea, if you are able to demonstrate that this can generate some methodology, then it becomes something that you can use some more times. It's not just something funny, let's make a mountain. Oh, yeah, it's great. So you just make a scenography. Okay, here in Taiwan, there was a competition about to improve the tourism in Taiwan. And then we make many analyses about the tourism and the possibility that many people could go there. And the competitions were about three harbors here. In fact, one here, another here, and we won another later here, later on. This is an image that for me is very, when I saw this machine in Mars, I discovered, okay, we are in the right direction, because when someone arrived to one place that doesn't know at all, they should try to understand what is happening there. And what is interesting is that when the men try to know what is happening in Mars, the first thing that they do is to study the geology. So the geology stones are the oldest things that are in those places. We try then, the first thing to, when you arrive to some places, to try to understand what is happening there. When you arrive to a party, you try to understand who is there. And when you arrive to one place, what we do is what this machine is doing, is to try to understand what is happening there. And geology is this very basic approach, no? So in this project, this is one of the harbors, the Fuji Harbor. In this project, we discovered the methodology that we were developing in some other projects, that is that architects arrive to one place and then they study the geography. But the geography means many things. Geography can be the island, one island, or can be some mountains, or can be a tree, or can be a rock, or can be a mineral, or, as you know, geography, there are physical geography, or economical geography, or social geography. You will see the Sociopolis project is based in a social geography. In this project, we're dealing with the idea of the geography. Then we recognize that there are some geographies. What architects always does is to measure them. Then is to generate some geometries that are very basic, based in what they see. No? For example, the island, following the Mandelbrot, there is this text by Mandelbrot, how long is the cost of Britain? No? That I make many projects of. In my competition, I wrote a text saying, how long is the cost of Taiwan? And we were saying that you don't like. Well, geography, geometry, you can measure trees, rocks. Here we measure rocks, we measure minerals. But then the nature of the nature is the logic that is behind all these things. Now, for example, in a harbor, You have the tension between the natural, the original line, and the artificial line of the harbor. Or in a tree, you can study the trees, how they are, the branch are organized, etc. No? Or the stones themselves, as you saw before, you can study what is a microscopic approach. No? So our idea is that after to discover some logic, basically architecture is based in structures. We must produce structures in which we organize our project. And based in these structures, then architecture happens. If you don't have a good structure based, in this case, in some logic, based in some geometry, and based in some geographical recognition, then architecture is something very vague, is something very epidermic, something that is floating. So we like to work in a structural approach, in this case, based in natural logics, no? And in this case, in this project, we use these different scales. We use the harbor or the coast analysis in order to produce the pattern for the harbor or the tree pattern or some others, no? I will repeat, again with this stone, with this volcanic stone, that we discover that has a very interesting geometry when you see in the microscope. Now it looks like something very chaotic. It looks like a Mars stone, but it is produced in the interior of a volcano. There is trying to move, but the material is trying to solidify, and they generate these bubbles with a relation of 180 degrees, no? Between all these three. And that's why they are trying to make, as you study here, the minimum or the maximum volume with the minimum surface, no? So what we thought is that we should generate here, because if the weather is so strong, we should do a roof, basically, in which the air should be moving very fast in order to reduce the temperature. So the idea was to make a kind of roof in that the behavior of this space was the same behavior somehow of the stone, where you put together the air that is trying to move and some kind of spaces that you try to organize in which you protect from the sun or from the water. No? So we propose different structures as umbrellas, and we propose to make this surface with different sizes of umbrellas, organized with a roof that has some water and some plants. With this, as you see, with this structure, so the air could pass through and could go up. And this was the structure that we proposed for the competition. No, some one space in which you have a roof and you have some kind of chimneys that basically allow that the air move continuously, and then what it generates is decrease the surface, the temperature of the environment. No? So again, in this case, we won this competition, and we are in those days we are finishing the detailed drawings in order to deliver. Well, those are some other examples about how, based in order to show that this idea, this methodology, can be applied to different scales. No, the idea that with a coast, Mandelbrot was discussing about which is the size of the rule that you are using in order to measure a complex form, and basically, when you make a harbor, basically what you are doing is making more coast, no? Making the length, increasing the length of the coast in order to allow the boats to stop in the maximum length. No? So here, in these cases, what we do is to propose some patterns. We propose some patterns in order to organize all these surfaces. No? The other harbor that was, this other harbor, there was a big harbor. We won two competitions at the same time. I will not talk about the program of the harbor, but again, I will show you this idea of having one surface, applying just some lines parallel with a constant surface, then proposing some program, some organization, and then generating like a different pattern that allow you to understand what is happening here. No? And then some buildings, as you see here, some buildings appear on this surface, basically as kind of a geological movement. No? In this case, we found another mountains. There are many quarries near the harbor because the people tend to cut the mountains in order to make the harbor, this artificial surface, and here we propose another mountain. And we play with another scale of the geometry, with this square. We're playing with the idea. I was visiting Taiwan with my kid, and always the kids are the most intelligent of our group, always the kids. And when he arrived there, he started to move around the rocks. And in fact, I have more images, but he started to jump on the rocks, and I discovered that the most interesting place here, the most interesting, I mean, that there is a lot of architecture in the relation of these rocks. This is one thing. And those rocks are, we were working with Marta Malé in order to discover which are the rules behind these rocks. And in fact, those are cubes that with one point in the middle of the side. I don't have the geometry here, but basically what we did in this square was to generate one roof that show the movement, the pattern that we were talking before about the movement. And in the other hand, these are the lines to explain this kind of many virtual lines that you can find between the natural and the artificial line. Or what we did was to, let's say, copy 16 rocks, 17 rocks that we found over there. And then with these rocks, wooden rocks, what we did was to make a kind of thin wooden garden, where the people could be sitting around and just creating an artificial landscape, but in a micro scale, not in a huge scale, but in a micro scale, with the sea. So this today is full of cars, but Taiwan is very complex, but what we were proposing was to clean it. Okay, I would like now to jump. Today I would like to show you basically three more things. The first thing is to talk a little bit about the Media House project, because this is, we have been talking about looking for logics in the nature or in the environment in order to act over it. But when we think about architecture, and within the relation between information and architecture, the interesting thing is that the structure of architecture is organized is very much related today with information. No, there are people that say that there are architects of information. No? In Microsoft, there are two or three people that are architects of information, because they use the word architecture in order to talk about the structure of the information itself. No? So here in the Media House project, the people from the Media Lab, this is a server, this is a microserver, the smallest microserver in the world. A server used to be the bigger computer. You have a server somewhere here that is the bigger computer. So what they did was to make the smallest server in the world, and the idea for this project, so we generate this Media House project, we were working with them. Today the relation of one space with information is this. You have a computer that controls this space. But the idea that they had was, why not to dissolve the computation in any space, and why not to transform the house or the architecture in a brain? That means that we have many neurons all over, and the intelligence is everywhere. It's not concentrated in a computer that controls this space. No? So our answer was, this was the Le Corbusier approach, that means to organize architecture in layers in which power or mechanical or whatever are different layers with different geometries. But in nature, this is not organized like this. One tree, for example, the arms of the tree are the structure, but at the same time, they bring their formation inside. No, there is not a tree with the structure of the tree and another layer that is like the savia, no, the liquid of the tree. No, so our idea was try to make a structure where we put everything together. This is how Gaudí was working, trying to put all the structure together and try to make, let's say, architecture with some natural logic. No, and well, I will pass very fast because this is only because I want to somehow to demonstrate that there are some other scales for architecture in which you can apply some kind of natural approach. No, in this case, those are the logic of the different topologies of the networks, and our idea was to make a structure in which you could connect these small brains in different ways. So I will, you will see some images and you will understand. This was the proposal. This is like the branch of the tree. Our idea was to make a structure that had the physical structure, the data structure, and the power structure all together. And then when you build the structure, you have already set up the network of the building. The Media Lab people were developing some buttons with these microservers were here, and the idea was that you could be able to take one light to put here, to take another button or to take whatever and to put everywhere. But the important thing is that the logic of this, if you take this light and you move there, today this will collapse. I mean, this light will not work. But by this way, the light itself knows where is the button that is controlling. So that means that the logical or the computation relation you keep even if you move from the physical world something. Well, there is this magazine, AD magazine, in which we were presenting the project. Those were the notes of the building. This was we got a theater in order to make this prototype of the house, and then this is you see this is like a very primitive architecture, no, like an Indian tent. No, here those lines already have the network inside, and then when you build this, well, this is the detail about what you have here. We were producing the website of a house. Every house, every building, and every neighborhood will have a website in the future, in order not only to control, but to know what is happening about there, in order to read what is happening here, in order to deal with the memory of the spaces, etc. Now, there is this book of the Media House project, is all this stuff is explained, you know? I'm showing this because this was the base for the Sociopolis project. No, this was the final result for the prototype in which we build this structure with different environments. These environments, in these environments, we were developing some media or some specific applications. There are some people talking about the chromatherapy or how the spaces could change the color based in the behavior of the people, or some applications to educate the kids, no? How the kids learn and how they develop their brain in relation of how the parents teach and how they act at home, or some other applications, no? The full-size video conference when you talk from space to space, we call this the chroma room, no? So the result of this project, or the kitchen with some information, etc., no? The result of this project is that what we discover, in fact, is that we should think about, again, we should think about cities and we should think about houses and apartment in some different way. The way we think the way we think about architecture or about spaces is not, let's say, fixed. And that's why here I'm going to show you a video. see if it works. At the same time that we were doing this, I proposed to someone to make a project in Valencia, to make an experiment like the Siedlung in Germany, in the Weissenhof, in which some architects could work together in order to generate new typologies. So here is the concept that we'll see applied to a house, but this, and I will explain how we are dealing with this in the city. We propose to make some buildings that were the sharing tower, because today the people, this is the digital society, where there are some individual, that is this round circle, and there is something public, that is the environment. But the people using networks generate some sharing spaces. That means Napster, that means sharing music, sharing whatever, no? This sharing situation doesn't exist very much in the physical world, because in the physical world, what exists is something that is public or something that is private. In order to share something, you really need to make something, an intersection between two things that are individual. In our institute, we were making a research about which are the elements that you need to have in your house in order to live. Because a house is not something generic, it's something that has some minimum requirements. And based on some functions, we discover or we propose that there are 13 elements that you need to have in your house in order to be like a normal person. No, I don't know. Check if you have all 13 things. Okay? And we read somewhere that people should have, one person should have at least 25 square meters for themselves. So if we take these 25 square meters and we put all these elements, this is the real scale, no? And if you have two persons, obviously you will have two times the same elements in a regular situation, no? Eight people now. Okay. There was a big discussion in Spain about how young people should live, how the immigrant people should live. And some people said we should make a small apartment for young people. And we thought that this is not exactly a good idea. Our idea is that the young people today is sharing files. Why not to share apartments? So here you see people sharing 2x2, some elements, or in this case, sharing 8x8, no? So the idea is that every house, the result of your space is this exactly. This is your house. So you remember here the circle with these elements. This could be your house if you have individual space, or this could be your house in which you have some areas that are pure individual, some functions like a bed or a toilet. In France, some people are sharing the toilet. In Paris, we say, okay, people should have their own toilet, but in some cases, you could share your kitchen, or you could share your living room. So that means that you are paying for 25 square meters, but you are using, in fact, like 100. So at that moment, we also were thinking, why people make walls? No, why people make walls in why there are walls in architecture? Basically, because you want to control three things. One thing is the view, another is the noise, another is the smell in the case of the apartments. Obviously, you are generating another climate with the outside, no? But this idea of controlling the view, what you hear, and the smell, we're trying to analyze which things of two different people we could put together. For example, here, you cannot see this. Well, here basically there is a relation between two different people, what they can share. So we're looking for rules of things that we can share, because we are, for example, we could allow to have a washing machine and then to have a computer over there, that there are many places like this, for example. But we could not allow, for example, to have my bed and to have the toilet of the other person, not in the same space. It could be a little bit strange. So basically, here what we proposed was to make a tower in which every floor should be different, every program of the sharing area should be different. For example, here, in this case, this is the staircase, those are the elevators, the people is passing from the private space to the share, from the public space, from the street, to a sharing space where you have, for example, the kitchen here, and you have the eating area, or you have the working area, or even the washing machine, but then you have your own private space. So there is this relation between sharing and individual, and our idea was to make that every floor in the tower should be different. All those elements, I mean, were like small, like these microchips from the media house. I mean, all those and these elements will have their own intelligence. Today, a bed is a bed. But we should think why one bed should be, let's say, should have some information or should have some intelligence, like a computer, like a table, like everything. In the future, all those things will have some kind embed intelligence, and the way we organize this should be connected with this. No, in fact, last week we agreed with the people from the Media Lab. We are going to build. I will show you the tower we are going to build, and we are going to make a prototype of this technology of these microservers connected with this space. No. So, for example, there are not baths in the houses, but only showers, but the people together have a swimming pool. So basically, the concept in this sharing situation is that the people, every person owns one part, every person decides to give some surface to a kind of a small community, and then you generate this sharing situation. No? What is important, and we were discussing, because this is from the video from the exhibition. We were discussing, for example, in Russia, this is the pile of all the sharing areas in this tower, the radiography of the tower. We were discussing why this is different from the Russian approach. No, in Russia, in the Narkomfin building, the people. So this is the space with the sharing space in between and the individual spaces. No, what I say here, instead to make a small apartments, this is a huge apartment. The concept is that every floor is like a huge apartment. In Russia, in these Narkomfin buildings, the people used to have like a common kitchen, but the kitchen was for 100 people. What is very different is like, well, this is the sharing space. The space. This is the plan that we saw before with the kitchen in the back and the sharing areas here. And then these spaces have color. And in fact, inside every individual apartment, you have your own individuality. No? So what I say is this: no, in Russia, what is very very important is this is again a question of how you organize information. If you put all the kitchen in the ground floor, then kind of individuality disappears. If four young people, as you, share a car to come to here, you are sharing a car. If 40 people share a car, then it becomes public. It's like a bus. So the difference between sharing and public is the rules that you organize between things. And this is a crucial thing, because before there was something organized by the public or was something that was individual. But today, the people using computers, sharing files, sharing information, are generating this kind of virtual communities. And this is completely different from the traditional city in which things were or public or private. Okay, so in order to finish my lecture, I would like to present this Sociopolis project, because this is very much related with these sharing spaces, but in a bigger scale. Because before, and obviously it's connected with the previous concept about the landscape, no? The city, in fact, is something like this. This was city, this is the historical one. Remember my diagram at the beginning. And this is the Champlé, no? This is the extensions. And this is not the city, this is agriculture. This, in the future, this is agriculture, this is the limit of Valencia. This is agriculture, this is the city. In the future, this will be this. So this will jump here. But this is what we have today in the just like 20 meters from the city. You have some incredible landscape. You have water passing through these kind of small roads. These channels were made in Valencia by the Arabs 800 years ago. And again, today urbanism is based in something that is like this, is a city, or something that sometimes is agriculture and then is one place where the city will grow. No? So here the discussion was how to do this. This is how the people in the middle age used to live, where there was a kind of interaction between architecture or something that was made by the men and some other ways to organize nature that was based in agriculture. No? For the Arabs, the huerta, the orchards, was its garden, but it was a kind of food garden. No? In England, you have a big tradition also about eating what you take from the landscape. No? This is the landscape around Valencia, but in the future, this will be destroyed and will become this. So this is the same concept as the sharing tower. The idea was, why don't we jump the scale? So we are coming from Mandelbrot, we are jumping the scale, and we are jumping in a scale that is a neighborhood. And we say, okay, let's make a neighborhood in which the buildings have one part that is individual, but the buildings also have some facilities, and then the people will need to go to the other buildings in order to live. So the concept is, let's make an habitat in which everybody, the people need to other people, and then that's why urbanity is generated. The opposite is the American way of life. Everybody has their own car, their own house, this kind of individual, and there is a huge consume of land, of energy, etc. The European way is based in cities. Cities is complexity, is contact of activities, and that's why cities were done until now. In Spain today, in fact, many people are making golf court. Many people from England is going to Benidorm. Benidorm is great. The periphery of Benidorm is a disaster. So don't go to periphery of Benidorm, just go to Benidorm. Benidorm is like this, is you have an apartment, you go to some other place. So it's this kind of complexity, you know? What I did was to propose to the administration, to the public administration in Valencia, to make an experiment, to make a micro city, having a complex program with facilities, with working places, with mechanical places, houses. And then I invite 13 architects. To every architect, we have an hybrid program. For example, to Willy Muller, he has housing, recycling, plan of recycling rubbish and supermarket, or some other, MBRDB has some kindergarten, agriculture, and apartments, and some others. There were 13 architects participating here. Another key issue, instead, urbanism was based in destroying the agriculture pattern. So here, what we decided was to keep the agriculture pattern, and then giving agriculture plots to architects with specific programs, only to make a kind of a sport path in order to generate some other relation between the different buildings, and also to generate public space with some specific rules that are the rules of the sport, the rules of the mobility of people running. Sport as a tool or as an idea to generate social interaction. So I will pass very fast this. This was the result with different buildings, with some small scale agriculture. And with this, we make in the Valencia Biennale, we make an exhibition with 13 models and 13 videos. The video that you show, my video, was used here. But what was interesting was after the exhibition, someone told me it was a very good idea. Let's make a neighborhood, a real neighborhood. And let's make it bigger. Let's make, because someone in Valencia, they discovered that they need many public houses for young people. That means cheap houses, because there are many people going to the Mediterranean coast to buy apartments in golf court. The price of the house is very high. So there are some houses that are not social houses, not just for very poor people, but for medium class people, but in, with a fixed price. No? So what they did was to give us a plot here, this area. So this is Valencia. Look, this is the historical center. So this is like the fourth or the fifth part of the historical center of Valencia. This is where the America's Cup will be in the in next year. This is Calatrava's macro city. And so you see here the tension between city and agriculture. This idea of discontinuity. Today we don't have yet everything the same. We still have agriculture in the middle. So in fact, our idea is let's try to keep as much agriculture inside in order to generate discontinuity, in order to avoid that Valencia that is here just connect with all of this, and we generate just, we destroy this pattern. So this was the plot. Is 30, this is the surface with square meters. This is like one kilometer by 7 kilometers, by 700 meters. This is this place, the, between this area and agriculture and the city. There are people like this here, no? And it's incredible that these kind of things, I was talking with this person, he said, I am a rich man. Because if I am with my horse in the middle of the city, you cannot pay this with money. So if you cannot pay this with money, this is because you are rich. I am rich. And he said, this is like a Mercedes. My horse is like a Mercedes. He's a genius. I mean, these people from the farmer are really genius. And that's true. I mean, if you have agriculture in the middle of your city, you cannot pay with money. And then that's, you are rich. So this is, again, some old buildings over there. This old building is here. And what I was really fighting, this is another key issue. The key issue is how the water is passing through here. This is the Arab channels passing, and the water is just moving with the gravity. Eh? The water is passing through here in order to irrigate this area. So the idea is that if you want to keep agriculture, you must keep the water passing through. Otherwise, it will be a theme park. If you want that this is a true mixture between urbanity and agriculture, you should keep the water passing through. You should keep these channels open, because when Valencia grow, destroy always this, destroy agriculture and destroy the 800 years old water channels, no? So this is the structure of the water. It's incredible, because here we have roads. Obviously we know where are the roads and all of this, but here it was much more important for this project how the water is. And in fact we were drawing all the channels like as if they were streets, because we didn't have streets, we had only water channels that for us were the streets somehow we should protect. I'm sorry it's too clear, but basically we decide that we should keep all this area in the center without any construction in order to protect. These were some tests that we did before. So the normal way to do this, this is the Cerda example, that this will be built like this. So the normal extension should be something like this, to destroy this and to put the Cerda grid. We were proposing some other approach like, in fact, this was the first proposal with some space here, free space with some buildings, no? And then some areas that were just pure housing and some buildings that were these buildings designed by some architects in Biden. So somehow a tension between a city, a regular city, that in fact the city could be like this, with some, this could be the traditional city. I would like to show you another, how we think about, another way to think about information, no? If we have a regular city, this is the traditional city of Barcelona, section 20 meters wide, ground floor plus 7. But if you take this block, you can reorganize the information in some other way. And here we have, we are in the traditional, let's say, Barcelona street, and this here in the other limit, you have, in fact, the American city. No, you have the city with towers. No, so from the Mediterranean city to the American city, what we decided was to stay here in the middle. We decide that this situation could be very interesting because what we could produce was these kind of blocks in which you have a street with commercial activities, but at the same time you have the interesting solution with views, air passing, etc. from this American city. No, if you see, this is the section of one Barcelona Cerdà street, and if you manipulate this, again, what you see is how the light enters through to the city. No? Here you have commercial activity, that means urbanity, but then you have also some other approach. So those were the first diagrams. The idea was to try to keep this as clean as possible, as green as possible. And this is the final solution. The final solution is, those are public facilities, that means a lot of public activities. Those are the water channels, and this is the new sport path that we put in the middle of the city. Sorry, this is the plan of many layers. This is, this could be another lecture about how we make a park, because then what we are doing here is, in fact, what we are doing here is a city with a park. We are doing something that has a lot of density in the site. This is another special park. This is the final solution, in which what we have is, we have some density here in the side, and we have like a huge park here in the middle. But so here you see, this is the big, this is where the old farmhouse is. This is where we are going to keep agriculture in the middle of the city. We are going to have also some these roads. You will see this pink sport path, a football field here. So what we did is, if you think what is happening in France with this periphery, with violence and all of this, is because there is no sense of urbanity, there is no sense of community. So here we have the maximum density that is allowed by the Spanish law, but at the same time we have the maximum free space that we can generate. And at the same time, we have the maximum amount of facilities where the people can go and can meet. This is one thing. And the other thing is that for the green area, what we do is to generate many contents or many arguments for this green area. In this case, we are going to have, you will see the image of this agriculture, where the people from living here, they will have a small agriculture area and they will cultivate it. We'll have a sport, a football here in the middle. So the main square is like a football court. And obviously there are some other plazas. And this is an art center. This is the building. In fact, the sharing tower is this one. Is this building with a public plaza here. And this is the construction of this. We has been 2 years after the exhibition developing this from the urbanistic point of view, and the construction of this, in fact, will start in at the beginning of March. So we make the design for all the landscape here. Well, there will be another explanation about how we organize the botanical species. We are going to have a botanical garden for fruit trees. We are going to have this sport path crossing through everything. So that means we have like many layers all together. This is like a street. This is the sport layer. People running. This is the football area, or there are some other paths. And then we keep some of those are existing agricultural areas. We are opening some of the water channels, because then all of this is a kind of air conditioning machine to contaminate all the environment, no? Some flower environment. And this is what is called the urban orchards, where people have these small plots that will be irrigated by this water passing through here. And you see that around these there are like some buildings. So this is the final image with this big space. With this is art center and this is a sport. This building is an hybrid building. You have the football field here. You have the vestiaries, the place where the people change themselves. But also you have housing on the top, or this is the building, or you have here a kindergarten with housing in the top. So there are these big big space with those buildings that somehow could control some of the in the middle. No? This is Willy Muller with people watching the football here. This is MVRDB. This is José Luis Mateo. All those are housing that are what in Spain is called social housing, but not for poor people, but for medium class. This is Greg Lynn. And this is the Shining Tower, the building I am doing. Thank you.
Well, we have a little bit of time for some questions for Vicente. Are there questions from you? Do we have a microphone ready? Well, perhaps while others are thinking of a few questions, one of the things that interested me was that in the earliest projects you showed, you made a strong case for an internal structure guiding the development of architecture. And in a way, one can imagine that this is in the service of a number of things. One of course, would be, you know, just the way in which you think about repeating this as a program of research, or perhaps even making it part of a pedagogy. On the other hand, you can imagine, once we get to the end, that it's also part of a way of maintaining a consistency in your dialogue with a large number of architects, and in fact a client body as complex as the one for Sociopolis. But at the same time, when you get to that, do you feel that you still have a hold on that sense of structure when you get to Sociopolis? I can imagine that's a difficult challenge, to find the balance between the diversity and that guiding structure.
Well, as I said before, for me, structure means, in the case of Sociopolis, that we were looking for the smallest thing, that means the structure of the water, in order to arrange everything. Everything was based in some decisions that were like very structural, were not. We could, for example, decide, okay, let's destroy everything, let's make some channels, let's do something completely different. But what we did was to, as we did with the mountains, to make the things growing from the side. Mm-hmm. And then here you don't find stones. What you find is water, and that's why we make things growing from water. Or in this building, as I told you before, the mayor of Denny of the mountain project, he called me and he told me, your tower doesn't look like a mountain. Yeah, because in some moment it looks like there are some kind of a stylistic approach to make a mountain could be something that is stylistic. But in my case, it's not like this. I mean, I'm trying to find some good answers to the good questions. And in this case, the question is how to make somehow some cheap apartments and to find some other rules. Maybe this case is too diagrammatic, mm-hmm. or here the structure is the structure of the relation of the people, more than, let's say, some kind of geometric approach of making architecture. But what I say with the structure is something that is very basic.
Yes.
Yeah. Are there questions now from any of you in the audience? Yeah? All right, well, in that case, we'll adjourn and continue this discussion over drinks, and hopefully in the coming days, the effects of this talk will burble through the AA. Thank you all very much, and Vicente, thank you.